you can buy the book outside, so just brought that on. Very big and heavy, and this is a test too. They're not as dangerous as they look, are they? But that was absolutely brilliant, and as you said, you've gone on much longer than it was planned, but it was great and well worth waiting and listening to you. We have got a bit of time for some questions, but I'd like to ask you a couple of things to start with. First is, how did you actually come up with the idea for these chairs? I mean, chairs are normally stable, and they're designed to be solid and sit on the ground, but this is actually quite run the whole way.
Lovely to be interviewed by Peter, because I've always thought of him as being like a David Dimbleby of architecture. It's funny to have him here. You know, I don't think you get enough credit at all for the role you've taken in the amazing design and architecture in London. I'll now talk about church. We never thought we were making a toy, a humorous thing. In the studio, we met a man who made timpani drums, and did the metal spinning for the copper, and they'd get a flat sheet of metal and a big wooden former, and I won't be able to find it because I'm a new computer, but I've got good footage of this guy who's with his bum kind of hanging out, but they would force flat sheets of metal and spin the bases that made the timpani drums. And when we were seeing it was human scale. That technique is used often for lampshades, but it seemed a body slice. And so one of the project designers, Stuart Wood, and I sort of were just talking about it in students, thinking, is there a geometry where the bit, could you make a rotational symmetrical geometry that where the bit your bum went on could also be the bit your back went on? And so we began this sort of process and ended up with plasticine and MDF and just adjusting and having to put all this cling film so you didn't get plasticine stuck on your trousers, and found a geometry that seemed to work and got him to make an aluminium one out of a series of metal spinners. But it just interested us that there's so many chairs and you're so used to cherishness. And just the sort of twit, and like the idea, it didn't look anything, it looked like you should put fruit in it or something, if you could find a rotational symmetrical form. But the actual things cost sort of, to really make them cost sort of £30,000. But then we've been working with an Italian manufacturer called Nagis, some of you may know, and we've worked on project after project after project and tried to do something, and each time it not quite working, and not quite being able to do something. We sent over the design, we didn't even present it to them, we just sent the design, and straight away they came back and, yep, fine, great, we'll do it. And within 10 days we were in Italy, and the tooling was in manufacture, and we realised it's because the other ideas were a bit crap. And he keeps going, have another idea like that one. And what if we can't? So these are made, and they're kind of sort of 400 euros or whatever, and they made sort of thousands of them. But we didn't realise with our logic of kind of, oh yes, a rotational symmetry, that it was, and you kind of thought, yeah, it'll rock because there's two points touching. I hadn't really thought that it really would do this, be able to go all the way around. My mum, who's sitting in the front row, has got a slightly grumpy look at me. She's the only person who kind of goes around like this and just gets stuck. She's got a very silly neck. She doesn't want to say, no, it does. Just like that.
On your website, you divide them between small, medium, and large. I think so. You don't describe furniture, architecture, is there a difference between architecture and design, or do you think it's the same process whether you start with a fork and finish with a stadium? It's a similar thought process that you go through to get to the conclusion?
So the studio's been going for 20 years, and the to start off with, it was felt very hard to evolve ideas, and it felt that there was this, that somehow it was my role to conjure up something. And in a way, the thing that I'm proudest of in what we've done is we've invented a system of a way of evolving projects, and a way of analysing, and a way of narrowing down and testing, and exploring options, eliminating things from your inquiries, and whether something is a Christmas card or a master plan for a site that's 8 miles long in Silicon Valley, we found it's exactly the same process that you're going through, and it's the same stepping back, trying to analyse, try ideas, and refine and reject, and that sort of rigor is the same. And so just it felt that that's actually stitches the more together. Yeah. And if your passion is solving problems, and just see everything as problems, whether it's a cauldron, a mixed-use 4 million square foot development in Shanghai, or it's just a problem to solve, and how you feel about it is part of the problem, rather than the notion that there's this sort of aesthetic conjury that happens, that some separate divine thing that drops. We set ourselves and we problematize everything. It's not very glamorous, but problematize everything, and by pulling apart those fibers to what all those elements are, the sort of lines within which I suppose you're trying to have success on different fronts.
Does that start to make a different answer from Peter, who was the job architect on East Beach Cafe? And so I said to him, what's the difference? Because he'd worked for a leading firm of architects, I won't name. And he said the difference is that in working in architecture, so you're loaded with dogma, and the relief of coming to work for you was that suddenly this dogma was lifted, and actually each problem, or each solution, was delivered in its own right, rather than with a whole baggage of, might say, architectural background.
I mean, I've loaded my brain up with quite a bit of architectural dogma and baggage, and learned to really appreciate and value, and I suppose I feel that the architect has a kind of impossible job. There's so many things that they're supposed to hold together, and that was what I learned really early on. It's like, my God, that's an impossible mix. And you know, there's one person who says, it's all about space. About the space. And it sounds brilliant. Yeah, that's really good, yeah. And then someone else is like, but it's all about sustainable performance of the building. Yeah. And the problem is it's all of those things, all the political dimension of how something engages with the world around it. And it seems that things easily swing over to one thing and actually I'll have a blind spot simultaneously to the human experience in another way. And so in what we're doing, we're constantly trying to do that from each other in balance of those different factors.
And before I hand over to the floor for a question, just what do you feel when you watch that Olympic film there? Because of course, most of your designs you go back and look at again and again, but that was just one moment in time. It's gone, you just got the film to record it. And that was almost a time when I'm sure lots of people thought that the Olympics are actually going to be all right. We've sort of cracked it, and to a certain extent, an awful lot has flowed from the Olympics for London and Australia. That was deeply a real moment.
I felt very lucky to have a chance to try to help our Olympics to be good. And I think that, in a way, it was a little microcosm. It was just fascinating how British people were sure it was going to go wrong, sure the Olympics were going to go wrong, totally rubbish. And then the opening ceremony began, and then it was pretty good. And then the games began, and then Britain started winning on that. And then people were expecting it to go wrong. And then when it didn't go wrong, it didn't go wrong. In fact, it was incredible. And it's just one of those things that says there's a lot about our British psyche. You know, it's kind of an amazing thing about democracy, you say all those things, and that we our scepticism is part of what's has the amazing thoughts come out of that kind of that. But that bridge project, the built momentum, because I think there'd be an assumption when the dome happened, there was the feeling, yeah, we ruined everything. And yeah, it was kind of it sort of confirmed people and put a real for a very long time embedded the logic that things go wrong. And so the I think that when I watched the cauldron thing, for me, I suppose I'm half thinking is everyone in the room sick of three of us? But you know, then I think, well, I'm on the stage, so I'll put it on anyway. It's also a huge relief that it worked.
I certainly don't think it's even yet. And actually, I did go onto YouTube and I watched the smaller film, which was somebody in the audience had taken on their iPhone. And actually, what you could hear was that people really reacting around the presentation film,
When I went to the Royal College of Art, you'd go to the summer show, and there was the design and the architecture show, and you walk around and you'd see, and it's like, and then there was the fashion show. Everyone was sitting, they had a ticket, they were there at the exact time, the lights came down, sound came on, and there was a lecture. And everyone was engaged in that way. And it's just so rare in the world of design and architecture to have a moment which is actually a shared moment for people. It drags on, people sort of see it in structure, and then it sort of drags into being. And so you can't get the intensity. And I suppose for us, that was, at the time I tried to see if it was possible to get, I should have tried harder, to show my work as a student on the catwalk. I was like, well, why can't I? We should have, why can't design, furniture, building ideas come down the catwalk? And it was just like, no. And I was struggling to do the actual thing. But it was that spotlight that you get. And so it was an incredible time at the moment, and it had been possible to keep it a secret. And so we also didn't know if people would have spotted the bits that had been brought in, and we also didn't know when people would spot the huge dark hole in the middle of the stadium. So to us it was obvious, and we just imagined that everyone else had already guessed. But we were deliberately trying to disappoint people. So that moment where all the pieces went down, and they were all lit, and our hunch was that British people, even though their heartbeat and all that stuff, would have a moment of going, oh, cauldron. And we wanted that disappointment. So, and I do believe that's what happened. When you heard, there was a spit. When it started lifting, that was relief that it wasn't flat. Creative!
So are you going to try your hand at fashion? Is that on you've done most of these?
Our interest is in ideas. I think that there are already some incredible people doing fashion projects, and I suppose we've been dedicating more of our time to built environment project because it's just so hard. It's so hard. What planners, architects, engineers are dealing with is so hard. And I suppose we've got such a strong, enthusiastic team. I suppose there's a sort of masochism just trying to work on, but trying to make the biggest difference. And it seems that the big public projects tend to be rubbish, and that was what I grew up expecting. And so, but if the occasional time when a public project is rubbish, so I suppose we're trying to dedicate our time more to that.
So, who would like to ask Thomas a question? We've got the microphone over there. So, this gentleman in the front here, bring the microphone. Anyone further in the back? Put up your hand, we'll get a microphone over.
What do you feel to be your most successful project today?
Your
the most successful project.
Well, you chose to do now, we come back on it.
I don't think of it like that. Every project gives me quibbles, and I look at it and know too much about what it's sort of doing for the challenge as well. But I suppose I showed that student project first, which I've not shown in a talk like this before, because that is deeply imperfect. If we had a crit on it together and stood next to it, we'd go, why did you use those tricks? Are you sure it was the right decision? It's imperfect, but it gave the, it revealed things that have been the basis that have given the confidence in trying to do certain things with the studio. So, it, like the least successful project in a way, has been one of the ones that's meant more to and has had a role somehow.
Another question.
Was it for you over dressed housing?
So we said again?
Like you'll never address housing.
We're talking at the moment about some new laptops and housing projects. Really hard, you know, hardly size things.
Yes, lady, you can turn right there.
Love to.
I was wondering what happened to the seed spikes after the seed cathedral was dismantled?
Because we always knew that the building was coming down. And so the Consul General in Shanghai, she decided to, before the end of the expo, to auction 16,000 of the 66,000 seed ends. And so she did it, the first 8,000, they went, so it was for a charity, and the first one went in 2 minutes, like a Robbie Williams concert. And then the second one went in 2 minutes, and was all. And what they hadn't sort of worked out was that then there would be this, because we couldn't have won. I mean, the Chinese Expo Bureau wanted people to make a real effort with their pavilions, and we were lucky that ours was kind of in that little handful that the Expo Bureau showed. And so it was the most visited British tourist attraction in 6 months, and it wasn't in Britain. And we had 7 million people waiting inside it. And so then what hadn't been predicted was that when it was the end of the expo, and they were about to take the pavilions down, they suddenly noticed that some of the security guards, when they were leaving work, bits of proceedings, and one of them sold for $20,000 in a resale. And so we have an exhibition at the moment that's just opened in New York, and the most expensive thing to insure is the little collection that the studio has of seedings. But the rest are in botanical institutes around the world and in schools. And occasionally you'll meet someone and say, I've got one. And you realise there's better than the ones you've got in the studio.
I've got one.
Who else? Is it lady down there?
Yeah, I'm interested to know what you think the future of architecture is.
So it sounds kind of weird. Where should I point my head?
Over there.
Oh, sorry.
Because I've met a lot of architects when I was done his first 3 years and is working in practice now, who are very dissatisfied with the work that they have to do. I mean, there's so many restrictions, whether it's from government through planning permission, or your budget, or the brief that you're given, or, you know, commercial companies requesting something really specific and generic. How have you encountered that in your work as a kind of a restriction, and also how do you think that's going to affect the future of architecture?
I mean, I think the challenge is not to become bitter and twisted. And I met many people, it seemed that was quite early on when I was researching, I met many people working in the built environment who really... and it seemed that once that's, you start to suspect the worst of your collaborator or commission, you're on a downward spiral in a way. But no one ever gives you an unlimited budget for anything, but always, every single project we've ever worked on, our heart is broken in the middle of it. And the challenge is to, I mean, there's this romance about what, if ingenuity and creativity. Most of the time, all you're doing is using any ingenuity that you and your team have is being used to figure out how something could really happen, what could be built, how to get knocked over and how to come back up with a smile on your face, figuring out why. And because often someone's got a good point, and it isn't a compromise because it's real that that's the budget that exists for something. And so trying to figure out how to prioritise it and how to not believe the whole world's trying to ruin your design. Because if you do, then you act like it, and then they do.
Question over there.
You've obviously got grounding in sort of making real touchable things. Do you have any thoughts on problem-solving ideas in the digital space or more like untouchable?
In the what space?
Digital or sort of any sort of more untouchable?
Not really. The passion is the three-dimensional world around us, and